morning, everyone. Welcome to our Twitter Spaces conversation today. My name is Matt Rasnick. I'm a producer for our social media team here at NewsHour. today's conversation is going to be on trauma of gun violence in America. And before I introduce our moderator and our guest, if you would like to send us any questions today as we continue this conversation, please feel free to share your tweet with the hashtag AskNewsHour. And then you can also find more information about the documentary that kind of sparked this conversation through some tweets that I'll be pinning above. Moderating today's space is the PBS NewsHour correspondent and host of the documentary, William Brangham. And he'll be joined by Joseph Richardson, a professor of African American Studies and Medical Anthropology at the University of Maryland. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, William.
Thanks. Thanks so much, Matt. I'm William Brangham at the PBS NewsHour. And as Matt mentioned, we're talking about gun violence in America and its impact, not just on the individuals, the people who are the victims of that violence or their loved ones or their family members, but also on communities all over this country, the places where this kind of violence is a much more regular occurrence. I mean, we all know the big public mass shootings suck up a lot of the media's attention, but they are a very small proportion of the lives that are lost and the trauma that is inflicted by gun violence in America. I mean, this is a lot of what we covered in our recent NewsHour documentary called Ricochet. You can see that on the NewsHour's website. But for that film, and again today, we are so lucky to benefit from the research and the wisdom of Joseph Richardson. He studies all these issues in all sorts of very, very interesting ways at the University of Maryland. Professor Richardson, we are grateful to have you back here. And again, if you have any questions for me about the documentary, if you have any questions for Dr. Richardson, please tweet them at us at hashtag AskNewsHour. He is really a tremendous resource, so please take advantage of that. So Dr. Richardson, great to have you back again.
Thank you.
Could you just remind us again, set the table in a way that we think of these mass shootings as, in some ways, a lot of Americans, if you ask them about where's the worst problem of gun violence, they'll say, oh, it's Uvalde, it's Buffalo, it's El Paso, it's Newtown, the mass shootings that we all in the media pay so much attention to. But as your research and the research of many others documents, that's not really the main way that gun violence plagues this country. And I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about where you focus your research and on those communities that suffer from this in a much more regular way.
Sure. So I focus my research primarily in the Washington, D.C. and Baltimore areas. And my research focuses primarily on survivors of gun violence, specifically Black men and Black boys. And what I would say is that for those who do not understand the significance of this problem in the country, is that 100,000 people every year in this country are shot and will survive. And so for me and the work that I do, I specifically focus on trauma and symptoms of traumatic stress, not only experienced by the person who was injured, but also by their family members and individuals in their communities. And what we have seen in terms of traumatic stress and secondary as well as vicarious trauma is that not only does the person who was injured suffered from trauma and experiencing trauma related to a violent injury, but also the individuals and families and communities that may, in fact, experience more trauma than the person who was directly injured.
I mean, this is one of the, in our first conversations, one of the most striking things about, again, your research and others looking at this, that people, I think anyone that has even a cursory knowledge of what a gun does to a human body would appreciate that that is an enormously traumatic experience to be shot. And those injuries, for many people, last for the rest of their lives. But your research finding that the impacts are not just on that individual, that they are on those close family members, on the people in that community, even kids that live blocks away from a shooting, I remember you talking a bit about. Can you tease that out a bit more? And also help us understand, when you say trauma, what do we mean by that? What does it mean for someone to be traumatized by one of these events? What does that look like? How does that play out?
Sure. So the study that I mentioned in the episode was based on a study conducted at the University of Pennsylvania, which found that children who live within blocks of a shooting often show up to an emergency department with symptoms of traumatic stress and mental health challenges within weeks of learning about that shooting. So children and people who are exposed to violence do not necessarily need to see the violence or be directly affected, but may learn about it through a neighbor, through a friend. And that also has an impact on trauma. So when we're talking about trauma, there are a number of symptoms where people who experience traumatic stress suffer from. The most common symptoms are hypervigilance. And there was a young woman in the segment who discussed always feeling like she had to be on point and was very vigilant about her surroundings. And what we see with people who have been injured and those who are associated with individuals who have been violently injured, we find the similar symptoms. So the inability to be comfortable in public, constantly looking at the pockets of individuals that are around them to determine whether they're going into their pockets to pull out a gun. Hyperarousal. For example, if you hear a loud noise and that loud noise may remind you of a gunshot, it will bring back feelings and emotions associated with that event. And we've also heard from individuals, which I found really compelling, is that we've heard from individuals who have been shot that when they hear sounds that remind them of a shooting, it often causes them to feel pain in the exact place on their body where they were injured, which I found to be quite interesting. And we don't hear much about that in the work on traumatic injury. So we have a number of traumatic symptoms that people experience, whether they're nightmares, the inability to sleep, the inability to feel safe, constantly feeling on guard at every moment of the day. And these affect quality of life, but they also impact one's physiological state. So if you're constantly in a state of fight or flight and you can never turn that off, that actually raises the level of cortisol in your body, as well as other physiological effects in your body that raise your allostatic load, which can often lead to early mortality.
I mean, it's just one of those things you think about. If you think about living on a day-by-day basis with that kind of stress, that, I mean, as you're describing, we know has long-term implications for people's health. And again, it's one of those things that when people don't make this connection between gun violence that occurs. I mean, in advance of this conversation, I remember looking at the news reports yesterday, three young men, teenagers in Washington, D.C. were shot yesterday. That was not on the news. That was not something that we were paying attention to. It didn't make the papers this morning. And yet these communities are living with that ongoing violence all the time. And as you're describing, the way that that ripples out into people's lives and into individuals' lives, into entire communities' lives, could you just talk a little bit more about what that does to a community? That if we know that these impacts, that if a shooting happens and even several blocks away, children can be impacted by that. I mean, you're talking about a public health issue that, again, doesn't really get a lot of attention.
Yeah, so we're seeing collective trauma in many communities. And unfortunately, there are not enough medical and mental health resources in those communities to address the level of collective trauma that we are experiencing in communities where we find high rates of gun violence. So in terms of even solutions, how do we solve providing services for communities that have been traumatized? That's a difficult question and it requires a significant amount of investment. What we know in America is that there you know, one clinician for every 30,000 people. So you can imagine what the medical deserts look like in communities where you've mentioned three young people were shot in Washington, D.C. I mean, we have communities in Washington, which are east of the river, where there's only one supermarket. So you can extrapolate from that how many mental health providers exist in that community to address that collective trauma. And so when we have collective trauma in those communities, which often creates a sense of distrust, individuals are not engaged in relationships that are mutually supportive. We find that people become islands unto themselves, and then that's exacerbated by the level of distrust in law enforcement. And so when we see young people who are carrying guns, I think we have a misperception of why young people tend to carry firearms. And I think the assumption is that young people are engaged and have the intent to be malicious and to carry out violence against another person. But what we found in many of our interviews and discussions with young people is that they're just they're afraid and they're fearful, and many of them are traumatized. And this is their only response that they are able to use in order to deal with their trauma, in addition to engaging in substance abuse, the constant smoking of marijuana throughout the day. But there are many ways that they develop negative coping mechanisms. And ultimately, what we need to do in those communities is provide mental health resources to help people deal with the trauma that they're experiencing.
Right. It does seem that there is, I think, to people who are living outside of these communities, the idea that why a 17-year-old might carry a gun in his waistband, just as you say, you can lead to all sorts of misconceptions as to why someone is doing that. And think of that only in terms of, well, they must be up to no good. They must be using that because they're trying to commit a crime or they're going to rob someone, et cetera. But when you tease it out and describe what you're describing, in some ways it seems a very logical thing that this is something I need to protect myself, given where I'm living, given what I've seen, given what is around me. And again, we can decry that and say, I wish a young child in this country didn't feel the need to carry that kind of lethal force around. It's not an illogical or irrational thing to do. In our conversations, you mentioned some of the work that you do after there is a homicide, and you do a kind of anthropological forensics work, if that's the crude term I'm just using here. But I wonder if you could just describe a little bit about that work and the things, the commonalities, the things that you found.
Sure. So I am currently the co-chair of the DC Violence Fatality Review with my colleague, who is also the co-chair, Kenyatta Hazelwood. And we are tasked with reviewing homicide cases which occur in the District of Columbia. And we do that once a month, and we have a host of agencies that also engage in those violence fatality reviews: the Office of the Chief Medical Examiner, the DC Department of Health, DC Metropolitan Police Department, and Office of Victim Services and Justice Grants, and many other organizations who are part of the ecosystem in gun violence prevention and intervention in DC. What we often see in our fatality reviews, particularly among young people who have suffered from early violent mortality, when we look upstream at the factors that are common in all of the cases that we've been seeing, we see some very common themes, and I'll just list a few of them. One is the chronic rate of absenteeism from school and school failure. The other would be involvement in the juvenile justice system. In terms of their mental health, we see diagnose mental health disorders, and sometimes we see multiple diagnoses that often go untreated. And then we find that young people have been arrested for carrying a firearm and placed on probation. And so when you had the culmination of all of these things, when we look downstream and we have a 24-year-old decedent where we're reviewing their cases and trying to determine, well, what could we have done upstream to prevent this? Well, clearly we need to be in the schools in addressing chronic absenteeism, which often leads to school dropout, and school dropout is a significant predictor for going into the criminal justice system. And then we know the trickle-down effect of that is once you have a felony record, it's very difficult for you to get a job. And if you're not unable to support yourself economically, you often turn to economic survival, which will result in you engaging in crime, which may require to use a firearm. So it's cyclical. And if we need to address these upstream factors in order to prevent us from seeing that 24-year-old either in the trauma unit or on our list of decedents in our fatality reviews. And so all of these things are preventable in terms of structural violence. And by that, I mean harm that could be prevented. And so we can prevent chronic absenteeism. We can prevent someone from having a diagnosed mental health condition and not being provided treatment. We can prevent the effects, the negative effects of what happens when a young person goes into the juvenile justice system. And we can prevent young people from being placed on probation, carrying a firearm, and only waiting for a technical violation for them to remand them to prison. All of these things are preventable, which is why structural violence is a critical piece of understanding interpersonal violence and structural violence. And I mean the structure actually causing harm to specific populations. We can prevent that. So I want people to understand that in order for interpersonal violence to happen and what we're seeing in the streets of Washington, D.C. or across the country, we also have to look upstream at these structural violence factors as well.
Yeah, it is. When you look at it and you see those upstream factors, it does. It, in some ways, the conversation about gun violence, you hear law enforcement saying, well, we're just going to simply go after the sort of tip of the spear there, the young men who are carrying firearms and direct all sorts of task forces and efforts to try to do that. But this conversation, your research and many others pointing to this much bigger societal issue that we have to look at if you really want to try to tackle this. And I think that's something that gets lost in that conversation quite a bit. I know that you have spoken about growing up in a working class community in Philadelphia and how your own personal experience in some way informed, or I don't know if it led you to this work or made you more primed for this kind of work. But I wonder, could you share a little bit about your own personal experience and how that helps you be who you are today?
Sure. I'm a native of Philadelphia, a huge Eagles fan. I had to say that.
Got to get that in there.
Raised in a working class neighborhood in Mount Airy, Philadelphia. And my mother was a school teacher. My father was a blue collar worker at Sears and Roebuck, and they divorced very early on in my life. And I can clearly recall growing up at the onset of the crack era and what that looked like. And I don't think we've seen the level of homicides and non-fatal shootings that are comparable to that until now. And so for me, as a young person growing up in Philadelphia at that time, I attended the High School for Engineering and Science, which was one of the top magnet schools in the city. But I had to travel through very dangerous neighborhoods on the bus and subway to get there. And so my response as a 15, 16-year-old kid traveling to school every day through some very dangerous environments, I carried a knife. And so I can totally understand why young people carry firearms, because at that time I felt that my safety was in jeopardy. And I was a pretty good kid. You know, I was a pretty good kid in school. I played sports, but I still felt the need that I had to protect myself. And so when you fast forward to 2021, and Philadelphia has 562 homicides, breaking the record, which was set, I believe, in 1990, and we're on schedule to get close to that this year. You know, seeing the news every day with young people carrying firearms, I'm not remotely shocked because of the lack of resources that kids have access to in the city. And so as a native of Philadelphia and looking at the administration, and I don't want to go too far into a political conversation, but at some point we need to, the leadership of the city needs to take accountability for what we're seeing happening in the streets. There should be no reason why we have almost close to, you know, 200 young people who are under the age of 18 who have been shot this year. And that falls in the responsibility of the mayor, the district attorney, the police chief, individuals who run the schools. And so there's an ecosystem, again, of the lack of investment in young people and ensuring that our communities are safe. And that starts at the top, and it has to filter down. And I don't want to be too critical of the leadership of Philadelphia, but I have to say this for the record. You know, our mayor, Mayor Kenney, has not visited one victim of gun violence the entire time that he's been in office. And 2 weeks ago, we had five kids who were shot coming out of a football scrimmage at Roxborough High School. One of those kids was killed during that shooting. Again, speaking of mass shootings, and the mayor still hasn't visited his mother. So when we have that kind of lack of empathy, which then is reflected in the terms of the resources that we provide to these communities, there's no rhyme or reason why people could be why they could question the high levels of violence in the city. And again, that starts at the top in terms of how we approach violence prevention and intervention. And when you really think about it and put it into context, that level of apathy is actually violent in terms of structural violence.
Yeah. Given all of that, given the way we seem to, in many ways, avoid looking at some of the root causes here and some of the structural issues that you're describing, I wonder how it sits with you when we have one of these horrific public mass shootings like Uvalde, just to use the most recent example, or Buffalo before it, or the Tree of Life Synagogue, or El Paso, whatever. Everyone knows the names of these cities, unfortunately, because they become the focus of the entire country's attention, and all the media goes there, and we report, and we talk to the victims, and we talk about where the gun came from, and what drove this young person to act the way that they did. And then at a certain point, we stop that conversation and the press all goes home. And meanwhile, as you're describing, this level of violence is going on all the time and gets so much less attention. I mean, does our fixation on mass shootings in some way illustrate to you part of the problem that we have talking frankly about this?
Yeah, I think it's our fixation on how the media drives those narratives. And I mean, we have to be quite honest that the media often frames the way that Americans think about a number of issues. If we go back to the war on drugs in 1982, you know, 2% of the American population thought that drugs were the number one problem in America. But yet by the time we arrived at 1986, we had a full-fledged war on drugs. So, which was driven in part by the media and the sensationalism placed on the drug war. So, the media has a tendency to focus on these issues and uplift events that do not necessarily reflect the populations who are disproportionately affected by gun violence. So we have to be very clear about how the media frames those narratives. But again, ultimately, what we're seeing empirically is that those shootings are happening in urban spaces, and what we need to confront which we have neglected to do, again, in terms of structural violence and structural racism and issues around race. I definitely would think if we saw more of the victims, if we were uplift more of the victims, if this was happening, if they were young white kids in Washington, D.C. or in Baltimore or Chicago or North Philadelphia, people would be much more empathetic to the problem. But yeah, in terms of, and we have to have an honest conversation just around race. And if we change the faces of those victims, I'm sure we would have much more attention in terms of the investment in reducing gun violence in this country. But it takes an honest conversation by Americans and people to have the political will in order to address it. So, you know, at the center of all this, you know, it's unfortunate that it also heavily involves race, the perceptions of race, structural racism, and our inability to move away from the narrative that we're going to blame the victim, when the victim is actually a victim of other forms of violence, particularly structural. So that conversation needs to be had in the media. We need to reframe based on empirical evidence who are the people who are really suffering. And what we often find, and which is why I mentioned the war on drugs, I may have gone off on a tangent, but I think it was important to mention how the empirical evidence does not necessarily match up with what we're seeing, the media images that are being provided to the American public every day.
To that point, the last thing I want to ask you about is one of the, I mentioned sort of how unique your scholarship is, and one of the parts of your work is this project called Life After Gunshot. And I wonder if you could just tell us a little bit, to this idea of trying to understand and humanize and to see the victims and sometimes the perpetrators of violence as people with fully fledged human lives who are just like us and in empathetic and compassionate storytelling. I wonder if you could just tell us a little bit about that project, what you were trying to do with it, and what you're hoping to continue doing.
Sure. So Life After the Gunshot, and I also want to acknowledge my co-producer, Che Bullock. Life After the Gunshot emerged from a study which I was funded by the Center for Victim Research to engage in a researcher to practitioner project, which would have me as a researcher and someone that engaged in frontline work and violence intervention and prevention, which was my colleague, Che Bullock. And we started with interviewing 10 young men who participated in the hospital violence intervention program that I co-founded and co-directed at University of Maryland Prince George's Hospital Center. And it started off with just trying to humanize their stories, because we had worked with many of these young men for long periods of time. And we clearly understood that the decisions they made were often decisions that were the result of not having many resources or opportunities or alternatives. But they were still human, nevertheless. You know, they share the same human emotions that we do. They cry, they laugh. You know, they feel pain, they feel joy, they're compassionate, they're caring, you know, so all of they run the gamut of all the emotions that any human being out here has. And we wanted to humanize their stories, to shift away from blame, from victim blaming, because we often hear and even see in trauma centers sometimes that the way that they're treated by the police and they're interrogated in trauma centers, that they're blamed for being shot. And we wanted to counter that narrative of for young Black men who have survived firearm injury. So we started the project with illuminating their stories. And then fortunately, we had money left from our grant, which is always a great thing. And we started to expand our interviews to the cast of characters who are engaged in gun violence in the gun violence ecosystem and space. So we started to interview trauma surgeons, judges, defense attorneys, psychotherapists, violence interrupters, legislators, as well as the families and romantic partners of the young men that were involved in the documentary. And so we've gained a lot of traction. We've been featured on NPR. We've won a couple of film festival awards, and I'm just really proud of the project that we were able to humanize the lives of the young men that we work with, and people are able to see that they're multidimensional, they're complex human beings, as many human beings are, and they're very nuanced in their thoughts and feelings and ideas about the world around them. So
it's a sad state that you have to even undertake a project to remind our fellow humans that we're all fellow humans, and that the things that drive us are the things that drive all of us, and we just respond to circumstances as they're presented. I would recommend to everyone, it's lifeafterthegunshot.com. You can see it. I know some of your work is on YouTube as well. Joseph Richardson at the University of Maryland, I cannot thank you enough for taking the time to talk with us, both being a part of our documentary and for your ongoing work. Is really important wisdom and thought to add to this conversation. We are grateful to you. Thank you so much for being here.
No, I'm honored that you've invited me to participate in the project.
And that is all for our Twitter Spaces today. I'm William Brangham at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you so much for listening in and participating. As I mentioned, you can see Joe Richardson's work at lifeafterthegunshot.com. You can watch the documentary that he was a part of on PBS NewsHour. The documentary is called Ricochet. We have a landing page where you can see the film there. And grateful to all of you. Thank you so much for being here. We'll see you next time.